everybody. So welcome to the very first annual Knowledge Graph Technology Showcase. You might be asking yourself, why is there a showcase? Well, I often get the question, which tool is right for the job, especially when I am dealing with knowledge graph and modeling questions. And what I would like to do is share with you some tools that I often point people to, some that are new on the scenes, some that are going to be a surprise. And before you ask, none of this is sponsored. I have not been paid to do any of these. I reached out to everybody on my own time. They were kind enough to meet with me and film these. So I hope that these honest reviews, all of these are my own opinions that I often help people with when they ask me questions. I hope this helps you in your search for the next knowledge graph technology that you want to dive into a little bit deeper. All of the vendors that I'm going to be talking to, I have more information and their contact information in the description below. And if I missed any tools that you wanted to see me review, or if you have questions about the ones that we are reviewing, please leave them in the comments below. I and the people that I'm talking to will be able to answer those questions for you. All right, and so what is the criteria that I'm going to be walking through? There will be a summary at the very end of each video describing the answers to each of these questions, as well as a summary of any other little tidbits that we find out. So the main things that I ask are, what are the use cases that the tool is usually or best suited for? Also talking about that, what features do they have to actually support those use cases? That's pretty important in understanding if they're going to meet your needs. The other thing I like to talk about is what kind of data, what kind of format, and what kind of query language does the tool support? Two additional things I talk about, because I think they're pretty important, is first, interoperability. If a tool is not interoperable, sometimes it's a make or break moment. Other people don't mind if it's not interoperable. So we will certainly see people on both sides of the coin in these reviews. The other part is this SaaS or not? A lot of people that have small development teams or no development teams don't have the resources to set something up that's not SaaS. So I will be asking these questions as well as many more. So please join me in the next few episodes. So with that, let's check out this video's tool of choice, which is... All right, and with that, let's go kick it off. So Kevin, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, thanks very much, Ashley. So my name is Kevin Feeney. I'm founder and CEO of TerminusDB. And just a little bit of background about myself. I've a long history of kind of working in technology. Then I went back to university to do a PhD, and particularly working on collecting very large social science data sets and trying to build predictive analytics and all types of applications on top of that. And basically, you know, TerminusDB is inspired by trying to ease the pain of for developers of putting together like data intensive applications. And what I mean by data intensive applications is the applications where the data is changing and is more complex than coding can possibly keep up with.
Mm-hmm. That's a lot of our lives nowadays. It's a beautiful thing on one side where there's just so much more data available. And yet on the other side, it's very messy. It's complex. You don't really know what you're getting into all the time with that large set of data. So with that, Kevin, do you want to maybe show us a little bit about the tool and we can walk through it?
So the first thing I'm going to look at here is we got support for, you know, documents, particularly CSVs, because the reality is a lot of the structured data in the world circulates in CSVs. So this is actually loaded into the knowledge graph and repeated, played back to us as a CSV. So one of the features of TerminusDB is everything is version controlled. And we have branching, it, like Git does for software, we have the same for data. We can have different branch. And so just by putting our CSV into Terminus, we also get like, it's even though it looks like a CSV, it's actually a fast in-memory graph database. Mm-hmm. We get all sorts of stuff for free. We can throw big CSVs in and we get like sorting and paging and stuff like that. Okay, so we can just see, and this is kind of the typical use case where people are scraping data from websites, or they're taking data from some automated feeds that a tabular type of format. And if you want to build, you know, an application on the basis of this, you've got to basically turn these type of compressed formats that are rows of tables into things Because the key to like long-term data management, and particularly why graphs are attractive, is we get to, we can view the world as things and not disembodied rows. So for example, so we have a data modeling tool here. And what we've done here is we've extracted like the structure of that CSV into like a graph data model. And so here we've got our document types. We've got types like companies, we've got deals, we've got investors. And each of these, this is our data modeling tool. This allows you to you know, define all sorts of different types of properties. Mm-hmm.
Well, did I hear you correctly? Is part of this automatically being generated from the CSV that you've uploaded?
Exactly. Well there's a little bit of human intervention involved at certain stages. So for example, you can tell the system to use certain tables or certain columns to generate enumerated types. So you get like in the world now of your knowledge graph that you're building on top of the CSV, you started from the CSV row that had just these, mm-hmm. these columns, and we're building out a proper data model where now all of the categories that are in the data are now proper universal enumerated types that you can address it.
Mm-hmm. One thing I want to just note here for the audience is a nuance that I'm picking up on that is kind of unique, is kind of cool, is that traditionally when you are uploading a CSV or you know, that kind of data set to a knowledge graph, you then get again that tabular, which is the first visual that you showed, where you then can go in and calibrate it to make sure that all of the rows are being picked up correctly. And that happens in OpenRefine and a lot of others that are kind of building on that same thing. This gives it another step though, which I think is really helpful. And that is it's extracting what the machine thinks is the data model from that CSV. So it gives you a different interpretation of the visual to then play around with, but you're doing it as if you are creating that ontology schema rather than just looking at a tabular data, which I actually think is really cool and I haven't seen it done before.
Then what you can do, and the whole idea is having, we can branch, create whole branches of the database. Mm-hmm. So we can have, then we can work on that automatically generated one to make a much more proper, robust one. And this is one I've been working on a while. So this, it just breaks down all the various types of things into type hierarchies, like we've got angel investors and partners, and breaks everything out. We have investment firms, but we also have this class of things called ephemeral entities. And these are our inheritance hierarchy. So this is a class of things that has a from and a to. And this is important, like one of the most important things in building applications and applications that you can feed data to is putting the temporality in the right place, because all of these type of relationships like employment relationships, shareholding relationships, customer relationships, they're all temporally bound. And if you don't catch that, then once you start accumulating data, you're going to get confusion. And I think you're exactly right. Like some of these to actually, you know, break out what you see in that spreadsheet and actually capture all the knowledge, you have to actually pick up some subtle things. So for example, here for these deals, we have an investor, which is a company. We also have a participation relationship, which links them to the deal. But we also have a lead partner. You have to kind of split out because that partner can be mobile. So we give them a starter data model, as you see, as we, you know, we try and prepare a basic one. And, you know, we have tools for generating those from the input data. And then you can work on that data model, but you're bringing the data with you. And then the flip side of this is that once you get your data into, you can get it, you know, you define these things in document format. And so we can auto generate a lot of the interfaces for editing these, you know, for adding various fields to them, even complex fields like this. Mm-hmm. So you can drive a lot of the downstream application. Like these are auto generated things, but this is like a toolkit that people can build their own applications on top of. Like a data content management auto-generated toolkit. And the reality is for a lot of these modern applications, when you know, the data models and the requirements change so quickly that
absolutely
that you really want to be running downstream applications. And so this is just one, this is forms and visualizations and management. But we, you know, this also comes with, you know, one of the reasons why we think this is a really powerful platform to build applications on, rather than necessarily, you know, a database for analytics. Analytics is great, but applications basically, they go on over time. And so things like versioning and things like time travel, being able to travel back in time to see what your database looked like at any point in the past.
Oh, I like that. That's pretty cool. That's slick.
Exactly. Our message to the user is, you know, build a data model and we will generate a whole bunch of stuff for you from that, including, you know, interfaces, even if you're not going to use those as your final application, to get test data into the system to see if it all works, to see if all of your types are correct.
It's almost like you've created that wizard-like step-by-step process to kind of walk the user through creating that model and giving them as many waypoints and assistance pieces throughout. And then they can pick and choose to use them or not. But I think it's really helpful because sometimes when you're doing that data modeling, you don't really know the consequences of doing something. You're just doing it because it's logical. And then, you know, when you put it into the system, it's like, oh, no, the system didn't understand that logic. I need to fix it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's a very, like, it's a subtle and an art that requires experimentation. It's very hard to think out in advance all of the consequences of your actions.
So does your tool do any validation?
So we do a check like 32 properties of the class structure, including circular inheritance, including all types of mistyped properties. So we do, you know, a very, very rigorous type checking. You can put cardinality constraints on any of your properties.
Oh, cool.
We have the ability to put cardinality constraints in everything. So what we've done is we've created like a subset, a very kind of, which is basically strongly typed properties and class inheritance. Which you must define the structure yourself. And that gives you a validation schema. And then on top of this, you have a inference graph on which you can add any inference rules you want. So we kind of separate out the schematic closed world view from that open world L view, because the reality is like 99% of people's problems is just keeping all your data in these complex databases in a shape where you're in control of it. You know, you know, it just makes it vastly easier to develop applications on top if we have a regular and rigorously enforced structure and that we can ask the database, because again, you know, the benefit of having the everything RDF all the way down is you can just query the database. All of these little widgets are querying the schema in the background and saying, well, what type, you know, what have you got to, what have you defined about this property? So I know how to draw the user interface, or, you know, I know how to validate it in the front end.
And so it looks like, is there an actual triple store under the hood of this, or is this something that would be more of a modeling tool that sits on top of a triple store?
So under the hood, this is a lightning fast triple store. Like, the storage engine is built in Rust. It's all in memory. There's the modeling piece is done in Prolog over the top. But for example, we can, you know, we can query all of DBpedia in super quick time. So I can, so this is DBpedia, which we've cloned. There's also a SAS element, I should say. So all of these databases that you have, there's lots of publicly available databases on Terminus Hub. You can connect to Terminus Hub and clone any of these databases you want onto your own machine.
Oh, get them that's cool. With, I like that.
You know, and the way we make this work, we have the, it's an immutable data store built in Rust. And it's highly compressed, and we use succinct data structures, which are towards the information theoretic minimum with which you can store them and still have them indexable. So we store diffs to layers, and actually triples are fantastic for that, because the diff language is so simple. It's just these triples were added to this graph and these triples were taken away. This is a query, just to, as an example, this is over 45 million triples of DBP, and it still come and open-ended query, and it comes in at under 100 seconds. Good. The software is 100% open source. We have desktop packages for like Windows and Linux and Mac. We have a Docker with a kind of bootstrap configuration machine. We have a CLI.
So it's totally open source.
It's 100% open source. Now there is a subscription.
Awesome.
There is a subscription to the cloud, but it has a generous free tier. Where you can save your own databases, and if you make your databases public, you don't get charged for them. You know, under the hood, everything is JSON documents. Everything is an API you can hit up, so it's very much like a platform for people developing apps. And these tools, these type of viewing tools and tables and stuff like that, that are all kind of back end server paged and work with really big data sets, they're all just available as widgets. So, you know, the idea is to make it easy for people to build.
I'm assuming it's Sparkle that you're using to query this, since it's RDF. Is that
accurate? It is not. No. And there's a few reasons. So we have a data log, our own, and it has a JavaScript. It's like a JavaScript language and implementation. And the reason that we, there's a few reasons that we didn't use Sparkle. One of the reasons is because under the hood, this is actually JSON LD. So everything is a document.
Gotcha. Okay. Okay.
So you can save these guys in the database just with your database. So for example, you can say, I built this database and here's the interesting queries. I want to share those with people. And there's just other documents you can put in the database is the idea here. We have this kind of fluent style that we like because it's easy to write in coding languages. And as I say, this is kind of, you know, and it's pretty simple. You know, we just have a thing for a variable. It's a data log. So we can say, you know, give me all triples. V means all, basically. Tell me all the types of these guys. And we can kind of infinitely compose and extend these things by saying, and I also now I want to filter it by sub system document. I'm only interested in the document classes. And so you can kind of, we have all these kind of assumptions and inference operators that are right in the query language. In our world, to build, so if you look at the results of here, this comes back in a kind of infinitely sized sortable, orderable, paged thing, you know, even over very large data sets, which works. We can just put that together by wrapping everything in an order by in a query and do it automatically for every single query in the world. It'll always work. And you can't do that in SQL and you can't do that in Sparkle. And it just makes it really convenient.
I'm seeing while you're querying, it's very fast. There were a few of the data sets that you showed that were quite large. The one thing I want to ask is under the hood, how much data have you worked with in your tool? So I was wondering, like, what are the specs on how much data you can put into this thing until it breaks?
Okay, so that's a really good question. The biggest really that we have gone is probably 10 billion triples. We have graph visualizations, but they're all paged. We have table visualizations, they're all server page, all these type of things. So we've taken great care to kind of to build it on the assumption that everything is way too big to let in the clients.
Right. And so when you do let things into the client, how do you go about slicing that large data set into something that's going to be managed by the application?
So basically it comes to the query language. We can just wrap every query that comes in a paging and ordering thing.
Yeah. Okay. So I think I get it. So you can do the modeling because the modeling isn't going to be nearly that large. But then when you get into the actual population of the model, that can be very large. But what you're doing is you're basically saying, okay, you're not going to need to see the entire graph all at once in most cases. And if you, so what you do is you predicate this on what is the query you're running, and then you almost make like a named graph to visualize based on that.
Exactly.
This also seems like it lends itself to collaboratively working on knowledge graph schema together. Is there some kind of collaborative component where I maybe have a team of ontologists and they want to all be working on this at the same time?
Yes, absolutely. So through the hub product, like, you can define your own collaborators and you can specify, you can add private collaborators to any of your databases. This is a one clone button. So you just press that and you clone the entire thing as it is to your local database. Boom. And this is, again, like, it's really like the whole thing of dumping database out, recreating a model, getting it into a new database. That's a huge productivity destroyer, being able to kind of get up and running exactly where you were in this type of complex tool without having to do a lot of exporty type of stuff. I think it is hugely important. You know, if somebody really messes it up, you're going to be able, and you deploy an app, you can at least return to a working state.
Yeah, it's a risk and security matter too. I mean, if there's a bad actor that's messing with one of the data sources that's public out there, and you want to make sure that didn't creep into your products and your systems, having a rollback mechanism is incredibly important.
There's one other thing, actually, a thing that we're starting to do now, which I'll show you, actually, which is pretty interesting, and I think is also, you know, these are all labor-saving devices. So we're constructing databases that are kind of pre-built with a lot of useful categories and classes, okay? So this one is all the countries, okay? And it just has all the ISO codes already set up for you and all the relations with regions. Because I know from experience that, like, people have to recreate that all the time, and you never know where to find the things, and you never know if you got it right.
Congratulations. You have a really hot tool on your hands. It's pretty amazing what you've done. No,
thank you very much. Yeah. It's not just me, as I say, like there's a whole bunch, a whole team of us who've done fantastic work. And as I say, I have to highlight Francesca, who's great work in the model building tool, and Katie, who did fantastic work in like the CSV building tools and the front end, and then the whole Matthias and Gavin and the whole back end team. You know, it's hard to develop a database that answers queries fast. Data comes in many shapes and workloads.
Yeah, well, you've got a really talented team, so congratulations on that. All right, so thank you, Kevin, for walking us through this. And with that, how would anybody get a hold of you and the rest of the wonderful and talented people at Terminus if they are interested?
So in Terminus, you go to terminusdb.com. But we have also a very extensive community. We have a Discord server, which is, we have hundreds of members. It's very lively. Everybody's welcome to come along, ask questions. We have a discourse forum, which again, you know, it's very full of life. There's lots of interesting people who are interested in like all sorts of aspects of data modeling. And there's quite, you know, it's quite a home of people who are interested in how you put together and manage, you know, complex data models and knowledge graphs over time. So it's a really interesting community. So I, you know, encourage anybody to get involved. Also, you can come to our website. You can sign up there. You can download us. You can sign up for Hub. You can try out the tool. And, you know, there's, you can get in touch with the team at terminusdb.com by email as well. So, you know, we're not hard to find. We're all over Twitter and you'll find us everywhere where there are coders.